Welcome back to the Bitcoin Business Bureau. I'm your host, as always, Litecoin Leader. Today, we're going to give another coin review. And this is a coin that I touched on earlier in the summer when I was doing Altcoinopoly, but I wanted to re-release it so that people can get a branded video, one with the right names in it, because back when I did those coin reviews, I was putting like coin number 20, coin number 15 in the title. Wasn't putting the title of that video. So now this coin today is Ethereum. And that's one of the more controversial ones that I cover. Not everybody loves the direction of it. And I just want to point out that the price direction doesn't mean that the trajectory of the project necessarily matches the price trajectory. Meaning that the price goes up doesn't mean I love the project. So I have some misgivings about Ethereum. I'll put that out there and you'll see why in the news and the charting. The charting is not going to be reflective of my opinion of the project, because the value I think of the project, there may be underlying issues with the technology. So we'll talk about that at the end. But first, let's go over the news and the charts. Just a quick reminder that nothing in this video is considered financial advice. I am not your financial advisor. This is not financial advice. Seek out your own advice and do your own diligence, do your own research. Summarizing the history of Ethereum is a difficult challenge to do in less than 5 minutes, but I'm going to give it a shot. So it was originally launched in 2013, and the name most associated with the founding of this project is Vitalik Buterin. But he had many co-founders. He had Gavin Wood, Charles Hoskinson, two names you may have heard of from other projects recently, as well as several other names that are out there in prominence. 8 or 9 names have been associated with the founding of Ethereum. So none of them are still there. Only Vitalik Buterin is still there. Others, as I said earlier, have gone on to other projects. Some of them have moved on to other spaces entirely. But Vitalik is leading the charge for Ethereum. And it's quite the charge right now, because Ethereum is evolving from the first generation it was to its second generation. They're working towards Ethereum 2.0 right now. Ethereum came on the scene, and they were the number one coin for both a platform to develop on, and they created a standard called ERC-20, which a lot of coins adopted, as that was how some coins launched to be on the Ethereum blockchain rather than building one themselves. And they also, Ethereum put forth the first platform that could use smart contracts, which is a device that's used in the blockchain that resolves something when all parties involved in a smart contract agree. For example, if two people enter a smart contract to exchange an object for $100, the ownership of the object could be put in the smart contract. The $100 could be funded into the smart contract. When both people agree that they can transact between the two, the smart contract executes and the ownership swaps between the money and the object. So smart contract technology has been utilized quite a bit, and it's also one of the drivers behind Ethereum. Ethereum is really a platform that has multiple driving systems that have, there's lots of reasons that people want to use Ethereum, all right? There's ERC-20 coins and an ERC-20 project. It's ERC just stands for an Ethereum request for comment. It's basically a proposal for changes. ERC-20 just afforded some coins to run on the blockchain for Ethereum rather than build their own, which jump-started the timeline for their projects. There's been other proposals for ERCs, some of them that are much more popular than others. ERC-20 is the most popular one. ERC-721 is also quite popular, and that's for the NFT, or the non-fungible tokens. That's the protocol on how to make a non-fungible token, which is wrapped into a smart contract. That is basically something, it's a digital asset that can be sold. It could be, and it's non-fungible, meaning it's unique. It could be a piece of art, piece of music, could be a concert ticket, could be a real estate deed, could be a patent, all different things that they can think of that could be unique can be put on the blockchain. And Ethereum is the number one platform for NFTs at this time. It's the fact that Ethereum is the top blockchain for a lot of use cases is what's really driving Ethereum and causing issues with the blockchain, because it can't support all the traffic it's being asked to do. There's demand for DeFi. That's probably one of the top sectors right now. The DeFi projects that are all out there, if you look at DeFi, you could see, just looking at the top 20 projects or so, they're all on the Ethereum blockchain except for Aave. So as you scroll down here, they all read Ethereum. I can't even, until I get to the Lightning Network at number 41 on the Bitcoin, they're all Ethereum. So everything that's running in the DeFi space, and we see how much the DeFi demand is increasing, it's just going up and up and up. Now I'll include these articles in the write-up here, but DeFi is already approaching $1 billion, and that was last September. So that's also leading the demand for stable coins. A lot of the stable coins run on the Ethereum blockchain. You have USDT, you have USDC, DAI, a number of these different coins that are out there. And now because the people want to transact and stay in the crypto space, they want to use these stable coins, and they're also quite useful for DeFi. So now we have, for the first time in May of this year, reaching $100 billion of stable coins. So there's another driving force behind the need for Ethereum, because all these stable coins run on there. So you have NFTs, which are driving a lot of use case. You have stable coins, you have DeFi, and you have the ERC20 projects that are all out there that are pushing forth to say, let's use this blockchain, and Ethereum can't support demand. So that's part of the problem right now, is that they need to get to generation two of their network, which is taking forever. There are some projects like Matic or Polygon and Loopring, which are helping with layer two scalability. All that means is another layer on top of Ethereum. Think of it as an express lane in a highway. So Ethereum gets blocked a lot at traffic. It seems like there's always a traffic jam on the Ethereum network. So layer two tries to provide a bypass that allows for more speed through the network. Doesn't always work, doesn't always satisfy every use case, but it helps. Let's transition now to the discussion of Ethereum 2.0 and some of the issues that is facing Ethereum and their path to get there. So what is Ethereum 2.0? Ethereum 2.0 is an evolution of Ethereum away from their first version, which was a proof of work where the miners created the blocks, similar to what Litecoin and Bitcoin do. Now, Ethereum 2.0 is going to be a proof of stake instead of proof of work, meaning that for 32 Ethereum or more, you can stake and become an Ethereum node and validate transactions, which is different than being a miner, where you buy mining equipment and do work and solve the mathematical equation to try to get the next block and get rewarded as such. So miners are going to have issues as we go to move towards Ethereum 2.0, because they're going to be phased out of their livelihood or their income of mining, because the miners aren't going to be getting nearly as much income anymore. So it's not going to be as effective to be mining at all. It's all going to be proof of stake. So where they're at right now is you've got the Beacon Chain. The Beacon Chain is phase one. That's started, and people are already staking onto the Beacon Chain. What's been delayed and what's questioned about is both the merge and when there's sharding going to be available. Those timelines keep moving out in the future. There's been questions about when that's going to happen. Right now, the latest date, it was supposed to happen in 2021, but now apparently it may not happen until 2022, based on comments from Vitalik Buterin. So again, they keep pushing it out, which is affording time to other blockchains to start to take the possibility of moving existing ERC20 or ERC721, which are other coins or other NFT projects, and moving them to different blockchains. That's why Polkadot, Cardano, Zilliqa, Theta, and a number of other chains that support smart contracts are starting to emerge as legitimate Ethereum killers. So that's a concern for anyone that's looking at the long-term future for Ethereum. So it's a lot to cover, and I could go on and on about Ethereum. I'm going to include several links here. I think CoinBureau did a good job of expanding upon this. A lot of these articles do a good job of adding more to it. I'll add more of my color on the whole Ethereum project in a few moments, but for now, this is the summary of where Ethereum is at today. So once again, I'm going to revisit how to chart Ethereum, and I'm going to look at Ethereum versus the US dollar and also Ethereum against Bitcoin. Now, as I've been saying on my videos for a while now, looking at against the dollar is not the right way to look at this, because we're moving away from the dollar. The dollar is dying. You need to look at it all compared against Bitcoin, but I will, for the sake of argument, do both. So On Ethereum versus US dollar, I see, in my eye, I see an Elliott wave, definitely an Elliott wave pattern on the weekly for sure. So what I see is that, and I'm going to do my famous Fibonacci retracements. And well, let's remove that. First, I'm going to draw in general what I think I see. Now, I'm pretty good at seeing patterns. So I've noticed a lot of people aren't, for better or worse. But what I could see is, I'm going to show what I believe is the Elliott impulse wave, which is a 5-wave pattern. So I think we're starting from, say, here, going, there's wave one. All right, I was able to get this chart on here somehow, but it wasn't the easiest thing to do. So what I did was, I see a 5-wave pattern. So I see that I'm going to move the zero to about there. So wave one goes up, wave two comes down, wave three goes up even harder, which will be probably up there, and there'll be a wave four down, and a wave five finally up. Now, I think that we haven't finished wave three yet, because as I talked about when I did the Bitcoin video, but that's a separate video. Maybe I'll link it, we'll see. So I think that this is the general Q4 to Q1, Q4, the end of 2021 to Q1, the beginning of 2022, we're probably looking at a bull run. That's typically what happens in the halving. Every 4 years, that seems to be the timeline. So, but that's besides the point. I think that we're looking at I can see that this is a wave one, and that's a wave two. Wave three is the strongest wave of all three. Wave four, as a general rule, never gets below wave one, the top of wave one. That's one of the rules of Elliott wave theory. So it would actually probably go about there. And then wave five would go probably above, almost always above wave three, but not nearly as big a dramatic move. The biggest dramatic move is wave three. So the way that we look at this, the way we can kind of confirm it, is we start to look at the Fibonacci retracement. So how do we show that this is wave one and wave two? Does it make sense? We start at the top of wave one. We pull back. Thank you. And we put it about there. Okay, so we want to see if that's about wave one. We want to see that the pullback of wave two, the bottom of wave two, should be somewhere in the green area, which is the 50% give or take a zone. So that's about where we're at. So that looks good. So now we do the Fibonacci retracement over here, and I almost always get this upside down. Yes. Can never tell which one. The first click needs to be one. I have to remember that. So if we're saying that that's the top, and that's wave the top of, and that's one, and the bottom wave two would be about there, then the target is usually 2.6. The 2.6 extension, with this being a 0 to 1 scale, because this is sort of it's semi-logarithmic. It's a Fibonacci series. So I'm going to draw a horizontal line at the 2.6 line. Start there, the horizontal line right there at 2.6. that puts Ethereum at about 7200, so call it 72 and a quarter, 7200, 7250, and I'm going to draw the 1.6 just for reference. Let's draw the horizontal line there, line at 1.6 there, and I'm going to change that to a blue line. Boom. Okay, that's 5200. So between 5200 and 7200 is the most likely target zone. Right now, today, Ethereum's in 4200 and change. The peak looks to have been, didn't quite get to 5000, but got really close. So the blue line is certainly attainable at 5200. We weren't too far from it just last week, or week before. So, but 7200 in a bull run seems very attainable, and it could possibly even go higher. I was to stretch this up a little bit, look at the 3.6, see what 3.6 looks like. Horizontal line at 3.6 gives me 9200. Let's make it green just to be different. So I've heard some thoughts of, could Ethereum get to 10,000? Of course it could. It's not out of the realm of possibility. So let's just say that wave 5 took it there. So wave three, let's say wave three gets to 2.6. Then we do a pullback. Maybe not a full 50% pullback, but say about there-ish. And then you would have, let's see, 4,500 to 7,200. The difference of that is 1,700. So adding another 1,500 or so, that would be in the 800. To, I could see 9,000. I think 9,000 is reasonable at the end of this bull run before we pull back. And then you normally get what they call an ABC correction, which is down, up, down. I could draw that real quick just to give a little bit of an Elliott wave lesson a little bit. Let's see if I can get the ABC pattern, the correction wave. So if it gets the week five, then it goes typically, you know, let's say A, B, C. And then the whole pattern starts over again. That's how it typically works. So Ethereum could easily play out this way. But the first target I see, and it's not fair to have that 0.3 above now, it's going to be in the future. So we could be shooting towards like this. So this would not surprise me at all. So the near-term target, I think you're looking at between 6,000 and 7,000 is a reasonable number based on what the charts tell me. But that's on the U.S. dollar viewpoint. Let's look quickly over at the Ethereum. Now, the Ethereum versus Bitcoin is a different chart entirely. So I don't see a five wave here. What I see mostly is a... It's kind of stuck in a channel here between 0.077 and 0.057. You could even make an argument that this is a flag and a pennant. I'm going to draw that real quickly. Let's draw an info line from, say, here to here. A little thicker so you can see it. There's a flagpole. And then I'm going to draw, can I draw a channel? Channel. I'll just draw two lines. I don't want to mess around. Parallel channel. There we go. So parallel channel, say, there, down to there. So that would be like a flagpole and a pennant. It seems to be, you could even maybe say that this is a triangle. I'm just drawing for artwork's sake now, but you could say it's going from there to there. And you get another one, the top line, they could be coinciding as a point. But if this is a flag with a pennant, which it could be, it's a long time frame for a flag and pennant because it's been months that it's been in this channel. But if it's a flag with a pennant, then typically it's going to jump up when it gets out, when it breaks out. If it breaks out in the upward direction, it will move up the size of the flagpole. And the flagpole is from 0.03 to 0.076. So we're going to call that 4.5. So you might go up to 0.12 or 0.1 and change. So that roughly means Ethereum would be about 8 or 9 Ethereum would equal Bitcoin. So if Bitcoin gets to, say, 100,000, Ethereum could get, well, if Ethereum gets to 10,000, it'd be about 10 to 1. So that's a reason that reaffirms sort of what we were talking about in the other chart, that, you know, it's possible to get into the 9 or 10,000 range. Again, these are just generalities and what the chart is telling us, but if Bitcoin is shooting to 90 to 100,000, Ethereum at 10 or 11,000, sort of 9 to 11,000 range, is certainly well within the realm of possibility. So that's what the charts are telling me. Now we go back to the summary for today. So there you have Ethereum. I'll give it a 3 out of 5 rather than a 2.5. I think the coin is mostly a utility coin rather than a value add project. And the reason I say it is this, Ethereum, you need it to do certain things. You need it to swap. You need it to do DeFi. You need it for NFTs. You need it. There are a lot of things in crypto you need Ethereum for. However, Ethereum's main, the two claims to fame were that they were a platform that people can build on, and they were the first with smart contracts. Now there's at least 5, probably 10 or more projects that have those feature sets or even better feature sets. So Ethereum keeps trying to get to Ethereum 2.0, moving from proof of work to proof of stake. No project's ever done that before, and there's many questions as to whether that's even possible. That's why Ethereum 2.0 keeps getting pushed out further and further in time. And many people point out, like, look at all the developers working on Ethereum. I said, well, if you have a lot of firefighters, where do you send them? Where the fires are. So
That could mean that Ethereum could be, they could be making great progress, or there could be lots of problems, and that's why there's so many people working on the project. So what I do know is that the timeline for Ethereum 2.0 keeps moving further and further out in time, which isn't a positive sign. However, the price keeps going up. So those two things are at war with each other. So how do I rectify them and manage those two thoughts in my head? I think the price can continue to go up because right now Ethereum is the, until there's a true Ethereum killer, like a Cardano or Polkadot or Zilliqa, Theta, Cosmos, one of those Solana, one of those projects comes along and wipes out Ethereum as the big dog. Ethereum is going to be the big dog, and it's probably going to lead the price action in the smart contract space and the NFT space and so on, DeFi as well. But until that happens, you know, it's Ethereum's the number one coin in the smart contract space. But I think there are a lot of competition and they're catching up quickly. So I still give it a 3 out of 5. I kind of like the project, but I think I like other projects more. That's really where I stand. I think that there's nothing wrong with getting timing. If you can time it right, you can buy Ethereum on a dip, and not financial advice, of course, but the trajectory for the price seems to be heading upwards and to the right. So there's nothing wrong with making money on a project and then seeing what the future holds later on. So lots said today. I hope you enjoyed this review. For now, I'm going to close the drawer on the bureau, and I'll see you next time. Yeah.